The interest between me and Marie started when there was this interesting hypothesis that one of the reasons that the children may have not interest for others is that there is a lack, at least partly, of the motivation. And I was working on a circuit in the brain that is really related to motivated behavior, that is the reward system. And so we started with this idea that maybe there are deficits in the circuit related to the motivational circuit, so in the reward system, that may explain some of the deficit in this patient. So I work in animal model, I work with mice that are actually very sociable species. So we can reproduce in animal and observe in animal some of social behavior, where for social behavior we really look at the interaction between two mice of the same species, of the same age, that are sex match in this case, and we really study the social approach in the context of motivation, so how much they are motivated to interact with the other. So for doing that, there are different tests that we can perform. We have tests where the mice have no other choice than interact with another mouse that we call a stimulus of a social nature. Or we can put the mice in a chamber where they can really make a decision. So there are very much decision-making tasks where the mice has to decide whether to interact with a stimulus that is of a social nature or of in non-social nature. So there we can really study which are the mechanisms and the circuit underlying this decision process. So this is the advantage of animal model, that we can look at the causality between circuit and mechanism. And then based on some of this data, then we can infer some hypotheses for the human research. So concerning my most recent data, because we say we focus on the reward system that is very implicated in the motivated behavior, and in particular on dopaminergic neurons, that are these neurons in the ventral tegmental area, then when activated, they can promote the approach behavior. So we decided to look at these neurons and look at record, we can in animal model record in vivo the activity of these neurons while the animal engage in social interaction, and we can really observe the firing of this neuron in a physiological context, but also in ASD-related mouse model. So how we can create or make a mouse autistic, if really can speak about autistic mice. So obviously the advantage is that there are several genes that has been described to be linked to ASD. So we can create a knock-in or knockout mouse model where we downregulate or change, mutate a gene that has been found in ASD patient, and we can observe whether there are any deficit in some dimension of behavior. So we can speak about not much maybe about ASD mouse model, but about social deficit in animal models that has ASD-related gene that is mutated. Mm-hmm. So thanks to this manipulation, genetic manipulation, what we could really causally link is that there is a deficit in the activity of dopamine neuron that is related to a deficit in social approach. And really we are putting all our effort to investigate why this neuron do not fire properly, why the activity is disrupted, so which are the mechanisms underlying this deficit, and why this leading to social alteration.
So what we are doing is that we use a wide variety of techniques, and there is MRI, there is EEG, but there is also eye tracking, which we use a lot. And with the eye tracking, you can basically standardize and measure very well how less they are interested by those social stimuli. So that's things that we do. What we study is we have preschoolers, so we have very young children. And the reason why we have preschoolers is because we know that if you start intervening with therapeutic interventions very early on, then you can help them a lot. And we know that it's something that happens very early, this lack of interest to people. And so what we wanted is to analyze, okay, when we diagnose autism, how do they look like? And then over the next 3-4 years, how do they develop? So this is why we basically took so young children. And now we are using eye tracking, MRI and EEG, and with that we measure if they are less interested in the others. And for that, some of the paradigms that we did are the same that we basically designed for mouse. So we discussed a lot in order to make it basically compatible, translated back and forth. A few things that we have is basically we show them on one side of the screen some moving people, on the other side we show them a screensaver or geometric object, and just by just looking at the preference is something that tells us how socially interested they are. So that's a very simple paradigm. We have many others like that, but we basically saw using that there is less interest to looking at other people, and that this can predict how well those children will develop mm-hmm. over the next few years. So if you're less interested, if you're looking less, attending less to it, of course you're learning it less. And so it seems very intuitive, but that's something that we could show. And then we see how the intervention basically can change those trajectories if there is anything that we change over the years. So that's how we look at it clinically. And then we use the brain imaging and we dig back into the same circuit that Camilla has shown are the one implicated into social motivation, which is the reward circuit. And we saw that there is basically changes in these reward circuits at the very basic origin of it, which is the ventral tegmental area to the nucleus accumbens. Mm-hmm. So we see structural changes in the circuit, and then we see the cortical networks that is basically bound to the circuit is also changed. And that's something that we can see using EEG or fMRI. So it's basically something that we want to see the developing cascade. Everything is, for instance, right now based on the social motivation hypothesis, but we also have new hypotheses yeah. that we designed together, because not everything is social in autism. And when we discussed together about the paradigm that you did in mouse and the one that I was doing in human, we were missing a piece of it. So we are now designing new hypotheses based on habituation, also like, oh, you remark the novelty, because that's something that children are able to remark very well. If something is too novel, then they basically get some more anxiety because of it, and sometimes they don't adapt to the situation. So that's something that we discuss back and forth and designing new paradigms, and we might show some of it next year.
Exactly. Yeah. Actually, it's very rewarding when you see that some of the experiments that you do in fundamental neuroscience mm-hmm. using animal model are also can yeah. mirror right in the human. So we were really excited about that, and yeah. trying to be, I mean, translation, it means that the research one of each other is fundamental, right, and informative.
Yeah. It works very well in both directions, because yeah. we designed some paradigms in mouse based on what we saw in children, and we also
yeah.
did the same in the other
exactly.
direction. And each time it's adding building blocks to something to better understand the trajectories of development
yeah.
for those children.